Hi, I'm Louis Falgu, and welcome to The Music Breakdown. And today, I've got an essentials review of the immaculate album Laughingstock by Talk Talk. As I'm sure many of you are well aware, about a week ago, the lead vocalist for Talk Talk, Mark Hollis, sadly died. And I guess that makes now as good a time as ever to talk about how much of an impact Talk Talk had on music. When you think about what truly defines a musical genius, I think one of my first criteria for that would be the ability to create something truly new, something truly unique, something that in some way can change the musical landscape. And with the final two Talk Talk albums, Spirit of Eden and Laughingstock, Mark Hollis, as well as producer Tim Freese Green and the rest of the band, created the genre of post-rock. Which doesn't mean that these two records defined what the sound would become later down the line. It was more that this group managed to find a way to transcend the rock genre without fully leaving it, and create new sounds using familiar instruments and band setups. And of course, there were other groups that helped to define the sound as well. We already talked about Spiderland on this show, and that came out the same year as this, and is possibly equally influential to post-rock as a whole. But I think something that separates Talk Talk from an album like Spiderland is this album has much greater instrumental variety. This album comes packed with a string section and clarinets and double bass. And yet, the last word you could use to describe Laughingstock is dense. This album is quiet and introspective and reflective. And this happens right from the opening of the album with the song Mirrorman, a song that invites the listener to look inward and reflect. Each instrument on this track usually plays a note at a time, leaving space for the next instrument to play something, and then for the next instrument to play something. Every single note that is played here is right in front of you. It's so noticeable because there's so little that's going on here. And a lot of the time, there's an eerie and haunting swell of strings underneath the whole thing. And each strum of the guitar is colorful and beautiful. I think now's as good a time as any to mention that this album is drop-dead gorgeous. And Mark Hollis's voice is at the front of everything here when he is singing. His voice is incredible, and every single word he says feels so poetic. It's like he just commands the listener to pay attention to what he's saying, even though he's very hard to understand on most of these songs. But that, combined with the subtle instrumentation, makes Mirrorman an incredibly haunting song. And it ends with a subtly beautiful string melody that really pulls out the tears. And right after this lengthy period of meditation, the song Ascension Day comes in and busts the fucking door down with these joyous walls of guitars. It feels incredible coming off of a song as quiet as Mirrorman to just hear such joyous celebration. It's really quite genius the way that these two tracks are structured. And that really is what Ascension Day feels like. It's a celebration. And every single time we hear these giant crescendos of guitar, it really feels like you're witnessing the birth of post-rock as a genre. And I mean, think about the time this was released and the fact that post-rock wasn't even a thing. I mean, the musical idea that is on display here on Ascension Day is just genius. It really is, and it's so forward-thinking, and it's like you hear that flash. It's like the big bang of post-rock. And Ascension Day closes out with just clashing guitars, just by the end of the track going completely offbeat. It's just like all of this noise just coming to this close. Until it really does come to a close, because the track doesn't even have an ending, it just abruptly cuts off into silence as we lead into After the Flood. And coming off of that abrupt close of Ascension Day, this lead into After the Flood is just truly flooring. And can I just say that After the Flood is like one of the greatest songs to have ever been created? Because it is. The song leads in with subtle drums and organ. You've got a really, really lush beat going on here, but it's pretty chilled and relaxed for a little while. And once again, every single word that Mark Hollis sings has so much weight and importance to it. And at certain moments by the end of each of these verses, we have these incredible organ swells, and every single time they appear, I feel like my heart just gets lifted out of my chest. This song is truly transcendent. There's a segment in this track, after about two verses or so, where there is a solo that's just a noise solo on the guitar. It's like one note being subtly manipulated for like a little over a minute straight. And this, over the gorgeous, lush instrumentation behind it, is truly one of the most stunning moments in music. I really do just feel like I'm being lifted to the heavens throughout this track. It is truly amazing, and I can't stress that enough. But after that incredible experience, we get the track Tap Head, which is arguably the emptiest song here. I mean, it's hard to say with other songs like Meerman, and we'll talk about Rune, but this song is like, it feels like it's missing something that those other songs don't really feel like they are. And this, with the creepy and eerie clarinet, as well as the eerie, haunting bass line, the fact that this song feels like it's missing something, it's eerie, it's tense, it's like, why is this song not complete? Why is it not full? And Mark Hollis's voice matches this perfectly. It's mysterious and eerie and quiet. Eventually, we get a clarinet solo, I guess you could say, where every single note is so rich and full. It's really amazing how much sound they're able to get out of the clarinet here. And it's really creepy. And all of this tension builds to this sudden moment where the horns become loud and dissonant. And it's like the song is just assaulting your ears with horror. It's truly an incredible moment on the record here that just sets me back with each listen. And then we get the song New Grass, which does seem to be a lot of people's favorite off of this record, and it's not really hard for me to see why. This might have the most beautiful melody on the entire record. Throughout most of the song, we're getting this repetition of this incredible descending guitar line, and I just want to point out how amazing the guitar actually sounds. And of course, Mark Hollis singing in a beautiful melody here. This song is really quite moving and powerfully sad. And there are moments in the song where the sound of the guitar gets explored a little more as it tries to play other things and other little melodies to change things up a little bit from time to time. And it really doesn't matter what this guitar is playing because it sounds so immaculate. And I think in lieu of Hollis's passing here, this song takes on even more emotional weight. It truly is something special and a one-of-a-kind song, even if it personally isn't my favorite thing here. And the album closes on Rune, which is rather similar to Meerman because it's a very hollow song. Throughout a lot of this song, you're just hearing this chilling guitar pattern, but once again, there's so much richness and fullness in this sound that it almost doesn't matter that it's like the only instrument you're hearing for a lot of this. I know I keep saying that this album is haunting, but that's because there may not be a better word to describe it. I mean, Rune just gets under your skin. And I'm not saying that it's scary. It's not like tense, like Tap Head really, but it's truly beautiful. It's like life-affirming stuff. There's one point in this song where more instruments finally show up, and even though in any other context there's still really not much going on, it feels momentous. I mean, this closer really stops you in your tracks. It's much like the opener Meerman here, where it really invites you to just meditate and reflect. And, I mean, after an album as incredible as this, I guess that's the best way to possibly close it. I mean, really, Laughingstock is just an incredible record. It's like a one-of-a-kind record. I mean, certainly Spirit of Eden is similar, but I feel like this album takes a lot of the ideas of Spirit of Eden and makes them even better. Now, honestly, this is an album that I could totally understand somebody just not really getting. I mean, even at its loudest moments, this album's still quite subtle. I mean, song-wise, there are no hooks here, really. It's certainly not a catchy album. There's nothing poppy about it in the slightest. It's certainly a beautiful record, but that beauty, again, is mellow, and it's something that some people just might not really pick up on. But it's really not often that you hear an album like this, even after post-rock has had decades to evolve. I mean, this album still stands on its own as just a masterclass in subtlety. And it's why I really do think it's fair to say that Mark Hollis was a musical genius. I mean, this is a complete work of art that defined an entire genre. it broke open the doors for tons of other bands to find new ways to use rock instruments. And for that reason, Laughingstock is an essential that all music fans need to hear. And now that I've said all that about this amazing record, I hope that anybody here who hasn't heard it will go and check it out. I encourage you to give it multiple listens. I mean, this thing took a long time to click for me. I think within a few listens, I understood its brilliance, but it hadn't like hit me emotionally yet. It took a long time. But I think if you give this record its due time, you'll see it happen to you as well. At least I would hope so. And as far as this series goes, as well as the channel, I hope to get the next Essentials out fairly soon. There was an album I actually wanted to cover on Essentials before this, but of course the passing of Mark Hollis meant that this was a must-do. And hopefully that can be coming soon, so look out for that. Bye, guys.